to those that are worshipping here with us, face to face, and those that are joining us online today. I'm glad that we are worshipping together in this place. Very, very glad. The psalmist declares, and he's having a tough time, David is having a tough time, and he declares in 71, starting at verse 22, he says, then, you know, he says, at first he says, you will restore me to even greater honour and comfort me once again. And I believe this is a prophetic word for us. There's going to be restoration even to a greater honour and comfort. Then it goes on to say, then I will praise you with music on the harp because you are faithful to your promises, O my God. I will sing praises to you with a lyre, O Holy One of Israel. I will shout for joy and sing your praises, for you have ransomed me. I will tell about your righteous deeds all day long, for everyone who tried to hurt me has been shamed and humiliated. There's a restoration that's coming. I believe although it doesn't look like it, I'm declaring that we are living in the year of Jubilee. A year of Jubilee, which is a year of release and recovery. So let's determine to live that way. Let's determine to live that way. All right, we're going to stand, we're going to sing. Dan and Debbie are going to lead us today to invite you to come stand and worship with us. I love you, Lord. Your mercy never fails from the goodness of God.
Goodness of God.
are so, so good, Lord. You are so, so faithful. And Lord, you run after us even when we run away. You come and you pursue us and you draw us into yourself. You make yourself known to us, Lord, in our deepest and darkest places. Lord, you are faithful, you are faithful, you are faithful. And you deserve all honor and glory and power. Oh, Lord. Oh, and how good it is. How good it is. How good it is to be a son, a daughter of the Most High. How good it is to know the grace, the patience, the mercy, the love of a good, good Father, a good, good God. Oh, Lord, how blessed we are. How blessed we are. And Lord, may our hearts just be so overflowing with joy and gratitude that we can't help but sing of your name, praise your name, give you the glory. Lord, walk with our light fully on, fully charged, ready to go. Oh, Lord, we praise you. We honor you for your goodness, your grace, your mercy. Jesus. Please have a seat just for a moment. Have a seat for a moment, please. Welcome, welcome, everyone. I'm glad that we're here together worshiping God. We welcome the troubadours, the troopers back into worship here. And it's so good to have you as a family with us again. Bless you. Bless you. And it's good to have the rest of your mob too. Put a smile on our dial, but the rest, that's good. You know, 2 minutes to eight this morning, we had two other people in church with us this morning. It's sort of like, what's happening here? But then all of a sudden we had 20. So it's, we always work on North Queensland time at Mission Beach, if you're ever wondering. If you ever think you're late for church at Mission Beach, you're not. Okay, so anyway, some announcements. Well, we've done the welcome. Is there any announcements there? Right, so our worship times is per normal. Online worship 10:30, and then next Tuesday service is on the 8th of Feb. KYB kicks off on the 1st of Feb, 9:30 here. Thank you. That's in your notices as well. Click. Next, I think Koinonia could be next, something like that. Yeah. Okay, so that's on the, starting on the 8th of Feb, 7:30 here as well. Is that right, Rod? Yeah, that's good. So all our things are ramping up, and the combined churches service is coming on the 13th of February, 6 p.m. at the Baptist Church. 6 p.m. Baptist Church, Sunday the 13th. And really encourage as many of us to get there, to come together as the body of Christ that lives and breathes in this region, and we invite you to come. And of course, if you're on the leadership team, there is a meeting coming also on Valentine's Day. So bring a rose. Yeah, that's right.
Trevor's
coming, so we've got all the roses. Oh, that's lovely. Okay, all right, so that's what's coming up. And leadership team, I have posted, emailed you something this morning, I think, about that. So don't look at it up now. Wait till you get home. I think that's all the announcements I had. I'm going to change things up a little bit. Has anybody got a testimony they'd like to share? Oh, there's a couple. All right, okay. All right, I'm going to start with the one that's going to be this, and then we're going to build. No, come on, okay. Come out here. Do you mind coming out the front? You're allowed to take your mask off, please, so people can see your smile face. Come up here, because then you'll be in focus.
Okay. I started the job 2 weeks ago.
Yay.
I do full-time in a banana farm.
Yay.
It's rough, but it's good. and the other thing is I've just bought a car. So,
yeah. Hey. Good girl, thanks. That's fantastic. That is fantastic. Would you like to come, Belinda? Is Elijah coming too? No. Is it okay? Is it on Facebook? Is it all right? Yep. Thank you. Thanks, Merv. This is, unfortunately, how a karaoke party ended up in London. Not such a good thing.
He's been quite sick since 2 o'clock in the morning. He's been vomiting, And she said, oh, look, there's a spot free at 4 o'clock. And I said, yeah, I'll take it. And she said, oh, no, wait a minute. If he's that sick and that little, maybe just bring him in earlier and we'll squeeze him in. And that conversation right there saved his life. Because he would have been dead by 4 o'clock that afternoon.
Yeah.
And by the time I hopped in the car and drove him from home, 15-minute drive, to Innisfail, he'd gone stiff. And his pale face had gone grey, yellow, I couldn't make it. And he was just staring into space. And the doctor had said to a GP I hadn't met before, and I couldn't waste time with all the, you know, small talk. And he knew straight away, you could see that he was really sick. He couldn't, by then his body had gotten stiff, he couldn't move his neck. And she said, run to the hospital, don't wait for the ambulance, run. And I rang Ray, and he came and we threw him in the front seat of the car, didn't put the seatbelt on, just brought it to the hospital. Hospital waiting for us, and they just started shoving cannulas in his arm without any numbing cream or anything. And he was just lying there stiff, there staring at the ceiling. My son was dying before my eyes. And I sent out a crazy message that just saying, please pray for Elijah. And they started talking about choppering him out. And I sent a crazy message out, and this is what it feels like. So I sent it to Pastor Mark and Pastor Mari and just some different ones. Really crazy. Saying, please pray for Elijah. No explanation. It feels like those people that prayed and then passed on prayer requests to others and it spread really quick. It feels like for me as a mother that you caught my family when we jumped out of a burning building. That's what it felt like. And you caught us with prayer. And I could take up the entire morning telling you all the things that happened, that I know the hand of God was on us and working according to the prayers that we've been praying. But basically, my son, we got to Townsville, and we were supposed to get chopped to Cairns, but the pilot changed his mind at the helipad, and we had to fly to Townsville instead. There wasn't enough fuel in the helicopter, so he would have had to fly back to Cairns, refuel, and then go to Townsville. He would have been dead by the time we got there. And my husband overheard the conversation and said, do you need fuel? And the pilot said, yeah, we do, but we're trying to map out where we can get fuel from. He said, I know a friend who is at Mundu at the airport, and he can catch you, and he'll fuel you up. And
he's right. I'm watching. He's not going to watch.
And that's Uncle Mark. And anyway, so Ray and May, and they met us at the Mundu airport and fueled up the RFDS, or not the RFDS, the rescue chopper. And flew us to Townsville, and that saved his life. And God just kept making a way. But in the air, out of everything that happened over those, you know, just under a month we were in Townsville, the most significant thing that I can remember is that when we were in the helicopter, and Elijah was really, really, really sick, and we didn't know what was wrong, with him. His heart rate started dropping in the helicopter, and the pilots and the doctors all had microphones and they were talking to one another, and they had their black helmets on, their masks. So I couldn't see, I didn't know what was going on, but I could tell by the machine what was happening. And I just started, prophesying into my phone, hoping that someone down on earth was there with their phone to hear me. And I just started getting text messages back agreeing in prayer, and I prophesied life over my son, and no brain damage in Jesus' name, no organ failure in Jesus' name, no ongoing complications in Jesus' name. And I said, I will not put my signature on a death certificate, for my God has given my son life.
Amen.
And God did all of those things. And we got to Townsville that night, and Ray was home with the kids, and praise God, Pastor Mari just happened to be in Townsville, and she could come and visit me. But because she got there, they put him on life support, and they were telling me they were very concerned about your son. And he's full of fluid in his brain, and
infection through his brain. They did all of the scans when he got there, and they were talking about taking a piece of his skull out to drain the fluid from his brain. They didn't know what brain damage he would have, and a lot for a mum to take in when all I was doing was just taking him to the GP that morning. In fact, I'd taken Christmas cards and popped them in my bag in case I'd be sitting around waiting at the GP clinic to write Christmas cards, you know. And then I had to deal with this. And they took him off for another MRI, and they were prepping him for brain surgery. And I said, Lord, I pray that it will not be what they think and that they'll be surprised by the results. And they came back from that MRI and they said, we don't think it's actually going to be needing brain surgery. He was in a really, really bad way. They didn't want to do brain surgery. They said, let's just try. And they drained fluid from his ear first, and that was the only surgery he had to have. So going from brain surgery to grommets in the ear. And that changed within 30 minutes from that to, okay, that. That is just the hand of God, and I saw that multiple times. So you can understand why all I want to see is to God be the glory. For the doctors that were there in the right place at the right time, the things that they could do for our son. But it is what he had done. And just different, I won't take up more time. How can a grateful mother ever stop talking about what God has done, and my husband, and my kids? But I haven't stopped talking. I've shared with so many people at the skate park through the week. I made two new friends. I took my kids there in the middle of the day in the heat because I didn't know where else to go. Elijah can't go swimming at the moment, so I've got to find non-swimming things to do. And I took them to the skate park. And Elijah was zooming around. This kid could not walk, could not talk, could not hold his head up. He couldn't lift a hand. He was all these things. He was floppier than a newborn baby. And 3 weeks later, I was chasing him around the skate park, telling him to slow down. Absolutely incredible. And and his mums would say, oh my gosh, your son is so cute. I said, no, he's not cute. He's a walking, talking miracle. And I showed them, I'd tell them what God has done. And then that mum left, which was an auntie with her kids. And then another mum turned up. And then I talked to her, we just had them over for dinner last night. And they know the Lord. But just being able to testify and glorify what God has done, it is an incredible thing. And I've shared many things with people. I could share many more.
Angels.
Have we time?
Yes.
If I listen to this on YouTube or watch this anywhere else, I'd be a little bit skeptical, okay? But I understand if you don't believe me, but this is how it happened. When we finally come home, I really should have my script in front of me. I typed this out because it was better. When we come home, the week after we come home, I had Elijah one night. We were at the dinner table. We'd been out all day, and we were really tired, and I was a grumpy mum, and trying to get the kids to have dinner and get to bed. And it was myself and the three kids at the table, and Ray was out in the shed working and stuff. And I'm like, come on, guys, hurry up, and just get dinner, let's get to bed, come on. And Elijah, every now and then, still has headaches. And some dizzy spells, and he is very good at telling me when he has headaches or when he's feeling dizzy. But his way of telling me his gauge of pain is, Mummy, I have Alvies, I did a helicopter, and that means he's in a lot of pain, that's how he describes it. Or, Mummy, I have Alvies just a little bit. So he's sitting at the table and he's rubbing the side of his head, and I said, Mummy, do you have Alvies? He said, yeah, Mama, I need a helicopter. Oh. And then he said, I need my Blade helicopter. He's always called his helicopter, his rescue chopper, his Blade helicopter, that's him. And my son was trying to distract him and said, Elijah, not a Blade helicopter, you say rescue chopper, it was a rescue chopper that came and got you. And he said, no, Blade helicopter, rescue chopper, Blade helicopter, rescue chopper. And I'm like, guys, let's get to dinner, I get to bed. And then Elijah, who was grumpy by now, he said, my doctors have angels in my Blade helicopter. work out where that conversation came from. I knew who I was. They were no, mum didn't say anything. And Esther said, Mighty, did you say angels in your helicopter? And he's like, yes. And I said, Esther, just shush, don't say anything. Don't want you to say anything. I didn't want to, you know, put ideas in his head. And I said, I just want you to go sit down. Mum wants to talk to Lodgy. So she went and sat down. And I said, Lodgy, did you see angels in your blade helicopter? And he said, yes. I said, well, how many were there, darling? How many angels did you see? And he said, 1, 2, 3. And I'm like, oh, that's the flight crew that were in the helicopter with us. There was 2 doctors and a flight crew in back with Elijah and I. I thought, oh, just check it out and just see. I'm trying to think, what can I ask without putting words in his mouth that I want it to be authentic, there's going to be something there. And eventually I said, Elijah, what colour were your angels? And he said, what? Okay, well, he doesn't really talk about white, he talks about blue, green, boy colours, green. And then I said, Esther's getting more excited. She come up, she's rubbing my arm, and Mom, okay, Mom? Why are you looking like that, Mom? And I said, Esther, just sit down. I don't want you to say a single word. Mom wants to talk to Elijah. Down, he's still eating his scrambled egg. I said, Margie, were your angels holding anything in their hands? Did they have something? They're carrying something? He said, yeah. And he takes a big swig of his little bottle. I'm like, what? I said, now listen to this, guys. What were they carrying in their hands, darling? What were they holding? He said, my head. They were holding my head. The helicopter, when his heart rate was dropping, and they had the doctor had taken out a case and just started pumping stuff into him while I was praying. And this was 15 minutes after I had prophesied life over my son, declaring no brain damage in Jesus' name. And he took my phone after, and he messaged on my phone and said, we think Elijah just had a seizure, and we've just given him stuff to keep his brain settled until we get there. Not knowing at that time still what he had. But in that time, when I got off the helicopter, there were 97 text messages on my phone. Not from 97 people, but a huge number of people texting me and praying in faith and just agreeing with me in prayer with whatever I sent back to earth. And I couldn't pray anything other than praying the spirit up in the air. I couldn't pray in English really for 3 days. I don't know how everybody stands about that, but that's how it was for me. I couldn't speak, I couldn't utter words, I could only pray in the spirit. And little did we know that while we were praying, that angels were there. You cannot tell a toddler to that kind of thing. You can't make it up. And if he was, we don't talk about angels in our house a great deal. I've said to people, I don't feel qualified to talk about angels. I mean, nothing really about them other than what you read in the Bible. And I don't really, emphasize it too much, or the pictures that we see in books. So where would he have gotten that from? If he saw something in a book, it would have been an angel holding a sword or a lamb or a harp, not a head. And then 2 nights later, Elijah was really quite sick. He wasn't sick, he was running around like anything. He was colouring spots, colouring rashes, and the fear gripped me. And I actually couldn't move my legs. I was standing in there, I'd just been changing Elijah's nappy, and I found all these welts all over his body, not called the radar. I could not move my legs from the fear of, here we go again. And I had to just start praying. And I was too scared to let him go to sleep, so I kept him up. And Elijah was perfectly fine about that. He was absolutely well, it's just that he had all these welts on his body. So I finally got him to sleep. I put him down at 11 o'clock at night. We're having a cuddle over his bed. And And I said, "Lady, I'm just going to pray over you and then you're going to go to sleep." He said, "You pray the angels, Mama." I said, "Yeah, I'll pray the angels." He's never said that before. And so I said, "I thank you, Heavenly Father, that angels around our home and around our families will sleep, around our children, whisper in their ear while they dream. Amen." I said, "Lady, do you remember those angels?" He said, "Yeah. In the back of the helicopter, they helped me when I was sick." I said, "Do you remember what they look like?" "Yeah, they're really big, Mum." So then I called Ray in and I said, "Don't stir him up, but I just want you to hear this." And then Ray said, "Hey, mate, did you see angels?" "Yeah, in the back of my helicopter. I had the angels," he said. "I had the angels, Dad. In the back of the helicopter. I was doing this. What did the angels do? They helped me when I was sick. The owies, my owies, my angels. Absolutely amazing." And the atmosphere in the room over those two nights in our house, it's not a word I could possibly describe, but I have said it's like the air got sucked out of the room. We were stricken by awe and fear of the Lord in our home. And who are we? Heavenly Father, would send angels to our son. But you never ever know what's going on when you pray. And it's not just hitting the ceiling and falling down. Prayer isn't to make you feel better, as if you're actually doing something. You know, when something's going wrong, you want to be doing something, and sometimes you can't do anything except pray. It's more than that. Really, you're talking to the Heavenly Father, and He is acting on your behalf. And it was happening right in front of my eyes when I couldn't see. And I was so fearful. My son had pneumococcal meningitis that he was vaccinated against, pneumococcal encephalitis, which doctors described to me his brain was on fire. Yeah, full of fluid inflammation and infection that filled up his spinal cord with pus. He had sepsis, he had blood poisoning from the infection. He had strep pneumonia from the infection. And then he had, had the middle ear infection, because everything was just full of infection, from a runny nose the day before. And then to be completely cleared up, he had hypotonia, all his muscle strength had completely gone, like I said, he couldn't walk. And he said to me in the hospital, "My leg's not working properly, Mummy." And he tried to climb out of bed one day, and he was completely confused because he'd slid down the bed, but he couldn't bring his legs, couldn't walk. And the doctors came and saw me the day after, the day that we were getting discharged. We had done one more MRI just to check on those headaches, make sure there wasn't anything sinister sitting there waiting to happen. And that all came back clear, completely clear of any potential strokes, seizures, infection, nothing there, just a 3-year-old brain. Absolutely amazing. But the doctor, they were just watching and him play around, playing basketball and up and down the playgrounds, and they said, "This is absolutely amazing." And I said, "I feel like a very emotional mom, because to me, Doctor, this is miraculous." And she said, "Yeah, we were pretty amazed." And I said, "But because everyone's wearing masks, like, it's very hard to read people's faces through that hospital journey." I said, "You all seem so calm and professional when you're in those doctor's reviews, and every morning those reviews would really fill me with fear, because we're going to tell me today." And they stayed so calm, and we started making progress. They were just like, "Oh, well, this is good, this is wonderful." And I said, you all seem so calm about it all, and I feel like I'm just wanting to jump out of my skin." She said, "Oh, no, you all go out to the hallway and go, 'Oh my gosh, I can't believe this is the same kid.'" One of the ICU doctors had come down to the rehab to be at peace where Elijah was 2 weeks later. He was seen to another patient. Elijah had gone from the sickest kid in ICU, the only one who couldn't go home for Christmas. We were the only ones in ICU at Christmas. the sickest kid to the wellest kid in the pediatric ward, and he would just get out to his brain around the pediatric ward and say hi to everybody and just go chatting to everybody. So this day, the ICU doctor was out in the peds ward, and Elijah, he just walked straight through this group of doctors, walked straight through them, hey, and then just kept walking. And the doctor was like, hey, little buddy. And then he saw me, and he spun around, and he said, is that Elijah? I said, yeah, he is. And they couldn't believe that how far he'd come in 3 weeks. To God be the glory for the things he has done for our family and acting on prayers that you prayed. I encourage you to pray, not just to comfort yourself, but knowing that things happen right in front of you, even though you can't see it. The things that we have seen and the ripple effect that it's been beyond our family and touched other people's lives, and they've heard Elijah's journey, has been amazing and humbling. I encourage you to bring your heart before God for your family, for your needs. But the one thing that was in my heart, sorry, because I'm so long.
Yeah, I'm loving it. Go hard.
Christmas Day. You know, Elijah had been taken off life support, and I was seeing how he was going. Yeah. So I'm just going to explain this to show you how differently I was praying through this than what I have. This is the third ICU journey with our kids. We've been here before, but this was the closest we've gotten to death with our kids. But I prayed so differently this time around than the other two ICU journeys. So on Christmas Day, he'd been taken off the life support of the intubation, but he wasn't responding. He was awake, but he was just staring into space. And the only thing he did that I actually recognized this was my Elijah is he had started to twirl his hair Christmas morning. That was the only thing that marked that was my boy, because I didn't recognize him. He wasn't acting like my boy. He wasn't calling for mommy, wasn't responding to my voice. But his heart rate and everything was settled, and they check him every hour, and they just had his hourly checks, and he was fine. And so I said, I'm just going to go have a shower. It's Christmas morning, and you know, it's just me and him, and I'm going to go have a shower and wash my hair and put a pretty dress on and just feel nice for Christmas Day. And so while I was away, I had gone to turn the tap on in the shower of the hospital, and this horrible feeling came over me, and a thought, just a thought, but it sneered at me, and it said, what makes you think you're going to be so lucky third time around? And I started to shake, because I thought, well, how lucky can I possibly be? This isn't going to work, this is not going to happen. He's, you know. And immediately, what came out of my spirit was a prayer. You know, you're praying in desperation, you know, and you're praying against fear. You would pray, God didn't give you a spirit of fear, power, love, and sound mind, right? Or you pray this, or you pray that, protection over my family. I thank you, God, you can do all things, and nothing is impossible for you. I've been raised in church all my life. I know all the scriptures. I've heard it all. But this time, what came out of my mouth before I even realized it was, oh Lord, our God, how excellent is your name in all the earth. And I just kept on responding to that fear. What makes you think you're going to be lucky third time around? Oh Lord, our God, how excellent is your name in all the earth. Oh Lord, our God, how excellent is your name in all the earth. And I don't know how many times I said it, but oh Lord, our God, how excellent is your name in all the earth. And I was singing in the hospital shower. And I was singing whatever came out of my heart. And the song was, I can hear a symphony of angels. I can hear an orchestra of heaven singing, holy is the Lord. Had nothing to do with battling fear or praying for my healing over my son or protection or anything. But I was just worshipping him because that's what came out of my spirit. While I was gone, Elijah had a seizure in his hospital bed. But I come back from praising and worshipping God and feeling like I had overcome this spirit of fear. But God was doing so much more in the unseen, did more than what I thought I was praying for me to get my soul strengthened up to face the day. But I was pushing back against the spirit of death that had come from my soul while I was out of the room. That's how I felt. And I came back and suddenly Elijah's room was full of doctors and nurses, and they were prepping him to take him down for an MRI, because when I'd gone, the nurse had gone and just checked his pupils one more time, and the pupil of his eye had blown up to fill up his eye, which is the only sign that they had that he was having a seizure. It was a silent seizure. And so they had to race him off another MRI and pump him full of stuff. You know, when you're praying, you don't have to go looking for all the right prayers to pray. You know, if it's fear, then look for scriptures on fear. Or if it's healing, then look for scriptures on healing. Just give God the glory. Oh Lord, our God, how excellent is your name in all the earth. It was, like I said, I've been raised in a Christian home and I've heard it all my life, but the one verse I could think of that day was just one. Oh Lord, our God, how excellent is your name in all the earth. And God was taking care of our needs. Well, we just kept giving him praise and giving him glory. I encourage you when you're praying, pray out of your heart and your spirit unto him. Don't pray out of what you've learned. It's coming on Sunday. Don't pray from here or what you can Google to help or what, you know, I've heard a preacher say, when you're in trouble, do you run to the throne or to the phone? Don't pray out of what you've heard on the phone or something. Pray out of your heart. And sometimes it is simply something like, oh Lord our God, our exhibition name in all the earth, and God will move on that. Give him glory. Raise up his name and glorify his name, and he will draw all men unto himself. I'm going to stop there. Can I pray and bless him over this church family? The biggest thanks that I can give to people. The biggest thanks and gratitude that I can have for people that called us out when we jumped out of a burning building that day and called us with a resting word of prayer. The biggest thanks I can give is the testimony, and pray a blessing back over you. Heavenly Father, I thank you for this wonderful church family that have embraced our families as we come. I don't even know everybody personally yet. But I thank you, Heavenly Father, that you know their name, you know their address, you know where they live, you know their situations, you know their health, their medical record better than their doctors. You know the relationship situations in their homes, you know the prodigals that they have in their family. You know all the things that are hidden that I haven't even mentioned, but you know them all. And Father God, I out of my heart of gratitude and this recent journey that we've had that has proven again and again of your power and your sovereignty. And that you can overturn things. You can overturn the medical predictions and the trajectory of how things are going to go, and you've completely turned it a different way and done it your way, because your ways are higher than our ways and your thoughts are higher than our thoughts. Father, I pray over every single person in this room and listening online at home, the ones who normally come or aren't here today, Lord, you know them by name. And Lord, I release a blessing over every home. For Lord, salvation is for them and for all their household. And we thank you, Father God, for angels on assignment for every single address. Father, we thank you, Lord God, that your arm is not too short that you cannot heal. And that there is no one too far off that you cannot reach. And even while children and prodigals are a long way off, just in the, as it was in the Bible, the story of the prodigal son, those who are still a long way off, Father God, the Father came to meet them. Even when he was a long way off, the Father saw and ran to them. And I pray, Father God, over the ones who have prodigals in their home and in their family, in their bloodline, the ones, Father God, who have known the Lord, but are not walking with you right now, filled with disappointment or discouragement or hurt. But Father, I thank you that you will run to them and meet them, that your angels on assignment will gather them and bring them into the place where they should be. It might not necessarily be the church or the building or the place where we think, but you will bring their heart to the place that it should be. Father, every person who has got continual questions in their mind regarding their health and a fear, the fear that I've experienced again and again in this journey, the fear that grips them, Lord God, and the discouragement because they're not getting the answers that they need, I pray a release blessing over their homes and over their bodies, Father God. As it says in Deuteronomy, the blessing will be on their food and their water, and that you will take sickness away from them. And Father God, I thank you, even those ones who are in the fire, that are standing in the fire, Lord, there is another in the fire with them. Father God, I pray that whatever journey that they're in at the moment, that it is a fire for them. Lord, you don't necessarily put out the fire and make everything rosy, but you walk us through the valley and you stand with us in the fire. And I pray, Father, over this church family, God, that as it's standing in the fire, they will know the presence of the Lord. Just as I did in that bathroom that day on Christmas Day, when fear tried to grip my spirit, but all that could come out of my mouth was glorifying my God. I thank you, Father God, that you'll put a song in their heart, that you'll put words in their mouth, Father, as they open up their mouth, that you will fill it, Lord. And they will be able to glorify you even in the fire, even in the dark valley. And they will come out of that fire not even smelling of smoke in Jesus' name. Let there be a complete release, Lord, even an explosion of your grace and your favor over this church family. Father God, the miracles don't just stop at one, but let it continue. Let the momentum build, Father. I pray that faith would build in the hearts of men and women, Father God, that you will strengthen them to be the soldiers of the cross that you've called them to be, the men and women who are bearing forth fruit in their lives for other people to see, because you said that people will know us by our fruit. I pray, Father God, the fruit of our lives will not be poverty and despair and sickness and disease, but the fruit of our lives will be a testimony on our lips of the glory of God and what he has done. I thank you that there will be peace instead of fear. There will be healing instead of disease. There will be less blessing instead of poverty. There will be a clear mind, a clarity of their heart instead of confusion and depression. That you will break all of those things, Father God, so they can truly stand and say, the Lord our God, he is God, and he is with me in the fire. Let healing start to emerge. Let testimonies of healing start to emerge from this place. Dig up the wells, O Lord, in this place. Dig deep the wells. Let the wells burst forth in this place again. Let rivers rush forth again. Father, over Mari and Pastor Mark, Father God, let rivers be coming forth from them out of their spirit. Let rivers flow in this place, Father. Rivers of testimonies of God glorifying words that our language would be to the glory of God in this place. That people will look here at this address and at our homes and our families and know that this place has been touched by heaven. Here on earth as it is in heaven, Lord. Here in homes as it is in heaven. Let the blessing just start to flow, Father. Those angels that were in the helicopter with us that day, we're nothing special, we're one of your kids. Let angels be ministering to this church family. Angels of heaven, dispersing every bit of darkness, every bit of fear, with the angels of light that come from heaven. For where light is, darkness cannot be. Let marriages be blessed. Unsaved husbands and unsaved wives, Father God, let their eyes be open and their hearts be melted under the presence of the Lord. You'll lift the burdens and strengthen the weak knees. Still the confused minds. Open ears to hear, open eyes to see. To anoint and just fall, Father, in this place fresh. Let songs just flow fresh. It's not going to be forced or scripted or just doing our best, but it will just flow naturally. Songs of praise in this place. Songs of worship, songs of adoration unto our King. Lord, we honor you, we give you glory, we give you praise. We just honor you. We honor you as King. We honor you, we give you the highest place. We love you, Lord. Would you just say that? Would you just say, we love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. We glorify your name. We praise you, Father. We lift you up in the highest place. For truly you are God. There is none like you in heaven and earth. There is none like you, Lord. We praise you, Father. We honor you. We reverence you. You are God. We worship you. We worship
you. Tissues, you don't need tissues. They come around the front here.
Thank you.
trust Him in our church to praise God in such a way. But it's such an important thing to do, I think, at this time. Thank you. Please be seated for a moment. I've got no idea what we're up to. No, my wife does. Good.
Such powerful testimony. Agree?
Yes.
This is the God we worship.
Yep.
But as we were giving thanks and worshiping God, one of the things that I guess also comes from my devotion yesterday and today was that Jesus' blood was shed for us to be redeemed so that our sins would be completely, completely washed away. Sometimes, like, that doesn't happen because, first of all, we hold anger, resentment, bitterness, but His blood was shed for that. That's what His blood washes away as well. So when we hold anger, resentment, or we become arrogant, our opinion matters more than yours. That stuff really, like I want to say, makes a mockery of what Jesus did. Because we're now saying we're bigger. This is making sense. But I also believe that this is where God is leading us as a church, as Belinda was praying this awesome blessing over us. We have a responsibility as well. The blessing that God gives is free. But what we do with it is our responsibility. So if we carry fear, anger, resentment, disappointment, we allow them to be bigger than Jesus. That's a lie. It's a lie from straight from the enemy. So how do we get rid of that stuff? It's but Jesus, God's given us keys. Repentance, forgiveness, humility. These are the keys of the kingdom that we have in our hands. Sometimes we tuck them away in our pockets. And we go, oh, where are the keys? I've lost them. I've lost the keys. But they're in our pocket. He's given it to us freely. So I just want to take some time before Mark does communion. Just to... You're doing communion. You're
doing communion, love.
So just take some time right now. Holy Spirit, Your presence is so powerful, so strong this morning. Would You come? Would You shine Your light in our hearts? Lord, we don't want to go muttering here, but we just want You to shine Your light. It's something You want to get out of the way, so that we can relate to You more fully, more freely. Just shine Your light, whether we have unforgiveness, resentment, fear, anxiety. Just shine Your light on us. hearts right now. Father, first of all, we ask for forgiveness. Lord, when we've carried this stuff and that's become bigger than you, Lord, we would leave them aside. They've become our truth. So Lord, would you come? Would you remove those sins from us? We choose to lay them at the foot of your cross, Jesus. Lord, we come to be washed in your blood. It's your blood, Lord, that restores our brokenness. God, it's your blood that redeems us. Because of your blood, we can be made whole. So go deep into our hearts. Deep into our hearts, God. So I speak in that forgiveness of, I choose to forgive, put in the name, in Jesus' name. You're speaking that to Jesus. Thank you. Thank you. You're a good, good Father. My Father, we ask, if there's sins where we have done, we've forgiven others, but we haven't forgiven ourselves. Right now, you just choose to forgive yourself. That's always a good one. We're happy to forgive so and so, we're happy to release them, but we don't forgive ourselves. So if that's you, today's your day. Thank you. Just wash over us. Wash over us, Holy Spirit. Afresh right now. Lord, like, so fill this place like you did in the upper room, Lord, that we would physically be able to see tongues of fire upon our heads. Lord, that we would see, like Elijah saw, your angels ministering to our brokenness, to our hearts, carrying our hearts. Open our spiritual eyes and our spiritual heart, that we would see and know what you are doing. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. There's nothing too big or too small for you. As Melinda said, you know our
sing again. So can I invite you to stand as we sing? Sorry. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Four verses. On the ground out the front here. That was just making my heart doing really good. It's done a bit of heart surgery. So nice to see that. And especially the way the truck was grinding the jacks into the carpet.
You don't have to tell.
I was going, go Elijah, go Elijah, go hard. That was really, that's what, so we're going to finish with the days of Elijah, by the way. So anyhow, I think we just, that's your song. Yeah, I know, you've got a song. Who else has got a song named after them? Anyone? All right. Let's share in the body and the blood of Jesus. Let's. Sorry.
Did you have any juice?
Yeah, we've got some juice. The juice is coming. All right. Okay. What a great day to remember the goodness of God. You know, like what a more opportune time would it be to share in this gift that where we get to see again, to engage again with the great gift of God, that hit the plan of God through Jesus Christ, you know, the giving of his life so that we all might have life and life in abundance. And the evidence of the presence of God in the present. You know, we worship, you know, we go, oh, we remember what God did then, what Jesus did then. But let's remember that what Jesus did then is for now. And that the Jesus that we worship, who died on the cross, rose again. Amen. For goodness sake, the hot cross buns have been out since Boxing Day.
Yes.
So let us remember, let's rejoice with the world that Christ died but rose again. And we worship a living God. Who willingly, when he walked this earth, gave up his life, who willingly gave his body to be broken and his blood to be shed, who took what the old and brought the new out of it, grace upon grace. You know, the Hebrew people had it right. They were worshipping God who was so powerful that he could even defeat the power of death. And here Jesus was saying, this is how it's going to happen now, forever, for eternity, for all people. So Jesus took bread that was set apart at that Passover meal, and he broke it and he said, this is my body given for you. Take and eat of it, all of you, in remembrance of me. And then later in that same Passover meal, Jesus lifted up the cup and said, this cup is a new covenant made in my blood. Take and drink from it, all of you, in remembrance of me. And I bet the angels were looking on. They're going, whoa, what's happening here? I bet heaven was looking in and leaning in awe and wonder. And we too should lean into this meal in awe and wonder. Look what God has done for us through the shedding of his, through the giving of his body and the shedding of his blood. So we pray, Holy Spirit, inhabit this meal, feed us, sustain us, enable us, but help us to remember, most of all, help us to remember what you have done. This we pray. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I'm going to check here with our worship leader for a moment. Near to the heart of God. We're going to sing as we a beautiful old hymn. Debbie Watson picked this one, but she's staying home because she's feeling a bit unwell. She didn't want to be the one that brought the sniffles to church. Thank you, Debbie. We appreciate that gift. All right, she'll be watching today, I know. So as we receive communion today, I invite you to join in this beautiful hymn, Near to the Heart of God. Murray and I are going to serve you this morning, so please. Thank you. Lord, we praise you and thank you that you pursue us, that your life is for us, that you gave your life for us. And Lord, as you have opened our eyes and our hearts, our very beings by your Spirit to that grace, by faith we have been saved and set free. And let us be confident of the pardon that we have received. Let me make a declaration over each one of you who knows Jesus Christ as Lord and Saviour. Our sins are forgiven, and we are no longer sinners but saints. And the past has no hold over the present. For this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Now, Merv picked a good day to be on the computer because we changed everything. So I want to change up something again. I want to ask Nia. We're going to finish with something for the young in heart, and then with the song Days of Elijah, which we picked prior today. So let's join together with This Little Light of Mine. This Little Light of Mine, I'm going to let it shine. So can I invite you to stand? I'm going to invite us all. Murray's going to take it over there for those that are online. Hang on a sec, we'll get set up. Thank you, camera lady. These are the days of Elijah. Let's join together and sing our final hymn for today. Testimony that we've heard today. We praise you, Lord God, for the provision of work. Lord, we praise you for the provision of life. Lord, we thank you for the provision of your body and blood in our lives. God, we are just so grateful, so privileged to be in relationship with you, and we honor you, and we give you the glory. And everybody who reads that, amen. Turn to the person beside you and say, God really loves you. And those who are online, God really loves you. See you next time.